Good afternoon. On behalf of Film Mutations and Multimedia Institute, I want to welcome you to the second day of the symposium The Unconscious of the Unconscious. Today we will hear talks of Željka Matijašević and Jonathan Beller, and along with the Q&A sessions that will follow them. I gave an overly extensive introduction yesterday to the whole event, and now we'll just highlight some of the themes that were discussed previously, and I'll try to connect them with the ones that will be addressed in the course of the day. As some of you remember, we were talking a lot about Lacan's extremely sophisticated theory of vision that constitutes the mode for accounting the stages of consciousness. He's a thinker who was enormously influential for contemporary understanding of visuality. But according to Jean-Joseph Gou, whose text raised some of the issues we had in mind while considering this event, Lacan takes the image always in the last instance refers to the phonetic, that it has no substance of its own, but is merely a bridge pointing toward the letter. For him, the verbal, the phonetic, the letter are at the heart of the mechanism of the unconscious. Željka's talk, whose title clearly alludes to Lacan's text, The Agency of the Letter in the Unconscious, or Reasons in Freud, will re-articulate the relation between the image and the letter and see how it can help us to think about some forms of modern psychopathology. The other topic we'll be tackling today, especially in the course of and after Jonathan's talk, is connected with the first one in several important ways. We will talk about the influence of technology impinges upon people thinking about their mind and, more broadly, their thinking itself. Technical infrastructures serve as a model of mind, both historically and contemporary. Let us take cinema and the discourse on cinema as an illustration of the thesis, deliberately, at least for the time being, avoiding a reference to psychoanalysis. Antonio Damasio, one of the leading neurobiologists, said that the movies are the closest external representation of the prevailing storytelling that goes in our minds. What goes on within each shot, the different framing of a subject that the movement of the camera can accomplish, what goes on in the transition of the shots achieved by editing, and what goes on in the narrative constructed by a particular juxtaposition of shots is comparable in some respect to what is going on in the mind. According to him, study of consciousness he conducts faces two intertwined problems: the problem of how the movie in the brain is generated and the problem of appearance of an owner and observer for the movie within that movie. Bernard Stiegler, from a totally different intellectual tradition, also insists on the cinematographic structure of consciousness in general if you think of cinema as a montage of temporal objects, that is to say, objects constituted by movement. With that, we are approaching the subject of Jonathan's talk, who sees modern digital culture as a successor of cinema and argues that the unconscious itself as the domain of unthought that organizes thought is computation. So I'll just announce Željka and... Željka Matijašević got a degree in comparative literature and French language and literature at the Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences at the University of Zagreb. From 1995 to 2000, attended a master followed by PhD course at the University of Cambridge, Trinity College, Faculty of Modern and Medieval Languages, where she was awarded by the degrees of Master in European Literature and Doctor of Philosophy. Her doctoral thesis addresses the issue of the relationship between Lacanian psychoanalysis and philosophy. Her main fields of interest are psychoanalysis and its connection with literature, film and culture and political theories, the relationship between psychoanalysis and philosophy, and the relationship between psychoanalysis and religion. Her books include Introduction to Psychoanalysis, Oedipus, Hamlet, Jekyll, Hyde, Structuring the Unconscious, Freud and Lacan, and Lacan, The Persistence of the Dialectic. A really fine book which those among you who are interested in reading of Lacan's ideas and their philosophical appropriation should read, definitely. So, please.
Okay, thank you, Ante, for this introduction. In my today's paper, I will just make a short introduction of all the themes I wish to raise. in this paper and certainly later on in my further research. So basically, Lacan's personality structure is threefold. We have the ego, the subject, and the I. In Lacan's later works, corresponding with the introduction of the real as a third order, by which the importance of the imaginary is played down, in his seventh seminar, The Ethics of Psychoanalysis, the dynamic of Lacan's concept of subjectivity is being engaged at the intersection and tension between the symbolic and the real, not between the imaginary and the symbolic as it was before. First, there is the ego, moi, captivated in the imaginary by the image. Then there is the subject, sujet, imprisoned within the symbolic, in the discourse of the other. And finally, the true I, je, the place of authenticity and non-narcissistic creation, organized around desire which has yet to be found, engendered and created, as it is not a pre-existing desire. Contemporary views on narcissism allow us to translate clinical narcissism into a loosely structured self, the fragile I, the non-autonomous I, with permeable boundaries towards others, or to put it in Lacan's terms, organized around the desire of the other, which makes the position of the subject extremely fragile, dependent, and self-defeating. Probing more deeply into contemporary theories on narcissism, I intend to demonstrate that our symbolic being, our construction as subjects, is also narcissistic. The reason, and what is the reason behind this? I intend to show that a closer scrutiny of Lacan's symbolic of the subject's relation to the death instinct, which is not biological but symbolic, and relies heavily on the mechanicist paradigm, leads us towards the consideration of the subject as being either functional or dysfunctional. And the prevailing idea of normalcy as being equivalent to a well-functioning subject, this functional subject leads us to the peril and pathology, which has many names, but I will use the term functional pathology. And we are speaking here of high levels of borderline psychopathology, those very well adjusted and highly functional individuals. Naturally, I intend in my later works to prove that today's dominant cases of most dangerous pathology are induced, produced, perpetrated, and hailed by the capitalist organization of labor. To connect psychoanalytic theory to social theories of the production of the most desirable self, the epitome of which is the American Psycho from Bret Easton Ellis's novel and Mary Harron's film, Patrick Bateman, as I find this extremely alarming. My work aims to deconstruct the false equivalence that the functional is the normal and that the dysfunctional is the pathological, in all cases much more pathological than the functional. And returning to the theme of our conference on the relation between the visual and the verbal, which is in Lacan articulated at the detriment of the visual, which is always perilous, psychotic, and bears all other and has all other bad words attributed to it, we have to ask ourselves, why is the visual so dangerous? And has the privileging of the symbolic led in some way to the mainstream view of the imaginary-based pathology as being the most perilous one, as it is dysfunctional? Images tear us apart, they fragment us, they atomize us. But the structure can also be permeated with the unconscious. Looking into Freud's heritage in Lacan, into Freud's investigation of hysteria as opposed to obsessional neurosis, investigated but not understood, because hysteria involves splitting, while obsession allegedly does not, we can say that Lacan's ego of the mirror stage is hysterical. So my question is, whatever happened not to Baby Jane, but to the obsessional subject? But actually, now that I've mentioned Baby Jane, we have clearly two types of pathology there, which can just very well illustrate that distinction between obviously higher pathology of baby Jane, yes, more salient, and but more much more dangerous pathology of her sister, of her controlling sister and obsessional sister. So basically, yes, they are somewhere between imaginary and the symbolic. The suppression of obsessional pathology may have contributed to the equivalence of obsession grounded in secondary elaboration language, the symbolic, the verbal, as being not very dangerous. The question closely connected to all those which I've just raised are the following. Where is exactly located death and the death instinct in Lacan's discourse? What gives life and what takes it away? There are several deaths in Lacan, multiple ways to die, mainly two. His whole discourse, I would say, is tainted with death. First, we die in the imaginary, as the fascination with the mirror image is laden with aggressivity and suicidal tendencies. Secondly, we die in the symbolic, in the structure of obsession as opposed to life. And the aliveness of the subject reposes in the intensity with which he manages to run his mechanical structure, insofar as he is the subject. Intensity which comprises risk, the danger of undergoing a short circuit, supplied by jouissance. For that matter, I will bring Lacan's subject into close proximity with the image of death, with fetishistic strategies of modern culture. How do you turn something human into machine-like, and how do you endow the non-human with liveliness, or with life itself? At the same time, the question, why is the visual so perilous for Lacan must be related to Lacan's omission of a borderline category. So once we step into the symbolic, in Lacan's view, we seem to be perfectly safe of any psychotic mechanisms. It is the Oedipal level, the paternal metaphor which steps into the picture and salvages us from psychotic disintegration of the imaginary. And, in Lacan's later works, save us from too close a contact with the real, with the maternal body. It saves us from the big crocodile, which represents the mother. At the same time, she protects us perfectly from the outer world as the jaws close, but that protection bears the peril of us being devoured and disappear in the crocodile's mouth, for the jaws may not reopen to let us out. So basically, this demonization of the visual, of the imaginary in Lacan, causes us to bypass other forms of contemporary pathology, borderline pathology, which can be very well imaginary and symbolic. And actually, I have been researching and writing on borderline pathology and its dangerousness for years, and I think I will continue to do so until I can work, as long as I'm functional. The concept of borderline is very vague, and it is often taken to mean extreme emotional intensity, a psychiatric personality disorder, and personality organization or structure in psychoanalysis. So one manifestation of this disorder bears the name of malignant narcissism, in the sense of malign. And in the sense of narcissistic metastasis, which permeate the whole personality structure. The structure is completely impregnated with the unconscious, but the structure exists. The unconscious is all-pervasive and non-localized, while the structure is co-extensive with the unconscious. The borderline, as defined in Otto Kernberg's path-breaking work, Borderline Conditions and Pathological Narcissism from 1975, comprises, as Otto Kernberg says, a fragmented sense of self, a pathological stance towards any object, the inability to integrate different attitudes towards the object, good ones and bad ones, in one attitude and in one object. In line with the internal splitting, every object is classified as either or, bad or good. One of the main primitive defense mechanisms used by people with borderline personality organization is called splitting. This defense mechanism is characterized by a tendency to view the world and other people in a polarized manner. as all good or all bad, flipping back and forth between these two extremes based on moment-to-moment perceptions. Lacan's work omits the borderline category, but paradoxically, it is a perfect articulation of the contemporary borderline subject, and this informs my research and my paper. There is this whole element in Lacan that we really have to investigate further as considers the borderline subject. My further research will focuses on the production of the borderline subject as the most desirable subject of late capitalism, as well as the ensuing production of diagnoses supplied by pharmacological industry. Let me just explain very shortly the ego. Lacan's concept of narcissism is closely related to the narcissistic image, mirror image, with its ensuing falsity, aggressiveness, duplicity, and lethality, the lethality of the visual. The mirror stage is fundamental insofar as it explains the constitution of the ego. Pertaining to the imaginary register, the ego is constituted through a rudimentary identification with a mirror image. In his mirror stage theory, Lacan takes off from Freud's extremely important paper on narcissism, Freud's idea of primary narcissism. The ego is thus created through the identification with an otherness, and that otherness can never be effaced, as it makes possible the very process of primary identification. The ego is, in Lacan, returned to the Freudian id to show that it is structured via images borrowed from others through projective identifications. The narcissistic structure of the ego is built on the double, the alter ego, the rival. The ego is a result of alienation, deception, or as Samuel Weber puts it in his study on Lacan, the identity of the ego, its homogeneity and unity results from the interiorization of the relation which is effective because of its heterogeneity alone. Another important thing is Lacan's view on aggressivity. Its roots are intrasubjective, as it results from misrecognition through which the ego comes to being at all by taking the place of the imaginary other. Alienation on which the ego is based bears similarities to the structure of paranoia, as the imaginary is illusory. The narcissistic structure of the ego is further connected with Freud's primary masochism and the death instinct, and it's completely deprived of any defense mechanisms, contrary to the theories of the ego psychologists. In his essay, The Mirror Stage, Lacan points to the semantic latency of the word narcissism, which includes two important moments. In the myth, Narcissus falls in love not with himself, but with his image. And secondly, the fascination of Narcissus with his own image leads to his death. This suicidal tendency is related to the identification process and its aggressive consequences. As Samuel Weber puts it, there is nothing before the image. The ego is inscribed in the chain of doubles as the split image of its alleged original. A simple formula for the ego would be, then, the ego is a copy without the original. And now, I will just say a few things about the subject. In Lacan's theory, the subject acquires its importance as it is crucial for the articulation of the unconscious, which will be distinct from the Freudian unconscious. To the psychoanalytic subject is entrusted the task of legitimizing the scientificity of psychoanalysis, and this task depends on successfully establishing the notion of the properly psychoanalytic subject. The notion of the subject is, in Lacan's view, the notion which will prevent psychoanalysis from falling into the vagueness of all pervasive worldviews. Among Lacan's works in which the question of the subject plays a prominent part is the 11th Seminar. Some of the ideas already articulated in Lacan's earlier essay, The Agency of the Letter in the Unconscious, also resonate in this seminar. This essay mainly problematizes Lacan's crucial definition of the subject as what is represented by a signifier for another signifier, and of the unconscious as a discourse of the other. Together with the famous statement, the unconscious is structured like a language. This essay also contains a shorter discussion on the Cartesian cogito, which is further developed in the 11th seminar for fundamental concepts of psychoanalysis. Lacan's reliance on the Cartesian subject as the origin of the psychoanalytic subject is developed in the second seminar. The introductory section of the seminar, Psychology and Metapsychology, attempts to justify the recourse to the Cartesian subject. As this seminar elaborates the notion of the ego, as its title suggests, the ego in Freud's theory and in the technique of psychoanalysis, the Cartesian subject is introduced in order to put forward the crucial distinction, that of the ego and the subject. The importance of relying on the Cartesian subject consists in that the Cartesian subject makes it possible to establish a historically existing pre-analytic subject. While inscribing the psychoanalytic subject into the continuity of the Cartesian cogito as its legitimate predecessor, Lacan attaches psychoanalysis to a discipline different from that usually associated with the origins of psychoanalysis, and that would be psychology. Precisely those who emphasize the ego as a unifying agency refer to psychology as a predecessor of psychoanalysis. Post-Freudian psychoanalysis is being returned to psychology through its misinterpretation of the Freudian ego. The symbolic order as a stabilizing order comes to the rescue by separating the subject from the image, by forcing him to renounce the symbiotic relation with the object A. How is it possible that this act of symbolic castration slash creation never comes to be approximated to any form of narcissism in Lacan? Lacan's pivotal Rome discourse emphasizes the dangerousness of the word, the words which define us, the names which exist for us before we are born and persist beyond our death, the words which make us fateful or renegades. On the one hand, Lacan oscillates between the restorative power of the symbolic and its linguistic dimension, language, while on the other hand, the words which create slash define us have a deadly power of annihilation, which is Lacan's true debt to Hegel. That is the question I posed before, the location of death. First, we die if we hold onto the imaginary identification. Secondly, we die as we renounce the symbiotic relation as we go through the process of symbolic castration and are subsumed under the deadly annihilating power of the word. There are several answers to this problem. Joel Whitebook, in his book Perversion and Utopia from 1995, in the chapter entitled Linguistic Turn or Bildverbot, speaks of Lacan's linguistification of the unconscious. For Freud, the unconscious is characterized by the primary process and thing representations. The preconscious and consciousness are characterized by the secondary process and word representations. The overall linguistifying tendency of Lacan's position leads him to obviate the difference between thing representations and word representations. Both are subsumed under the larger category of signifier. As Laplanche says, Lacan does not return to Freud, but stands Freud on his head. For Freud, the unconscious is imagistically structured, and the ego is mediated by language. For Lacan, it is the opposite. The unconscious is structured like a language, and the ego is an imaginary entity. Why the book's conclusion is that this is that in this process we can see Lacan's allegiance to the Cartesian mathematical standard of scientificality. Paul Ricoeur argues in the following way. It does not follow from the fact that unconscious discourse is translatable into conscious discourse that the unconscious is already linguistic. And I quote, "The form by which an instinct reaches the psychism is called a representative. This is a signifying factor, but it is not yet linguistic. As for the presentation properly so-called, Vorstellung, this is not in its specific texture of the order of language. It is a presentation of things, not a presentation of words. Unquote. So I will just make a brief overview of the real and the I. It is with the introduction of the thing into Lacanian theory that the subject comes to measure itself against the real as the third term. The symbolic order will be modified into an agency, exclusively keeping the subject at a distance from the real. Lacan's idea is now, with the emphasis placed on the thing, to posit the subject's truth as dependent not on the other of the symbolic order, not dependent on the other of the symbolic order, but on the non-mediating real to which the thing pertains. In that respect, in order to enable the movement of desire, the thing comes to be located increasingly in the register of the real until it finally disappears from Lacan's writings to be completely substituted by the concept of the object A. If the object A of the imaginary register and the thing of the register of the real swap places, what are the consequences for the articulation of the register in which they, of the registers in which they reign, and for the previous relation between the imaginary and the symbolic? One of the probable solutions. If previously the symbolic order was conceived of as the terminus, that is, as an epistemically exhaustive agency, now, with the introduction of the real, it seems to stand for the instance through which alone the beyond is accessible. In order to rectify the impersonal character of desire, suggested through its dependence on the other, Lacan makes desire revolve around the thing. Jameson sees the introduction of the real as the event which saves Lacanian theory from its irrepressible dualism, without going further into the implications of such a move. As Jameson says, and I quote, "Just as the symbolic order, or language itself, restructures the imaginary by introducing a third term into the hitherto infinite regression of the duality of the letter's mirror images, so we may hope and expect that the tardy introduction of this third term, the real, may put an end to the imaginary opposition into which our previous discussion of Lacan's two orders has risked falling again and again." Unquote. Psychoanalytic ethics itself is rewritten in line with the importance attributed therein to desire. The only properly ethical attitude for Lacan is therefore not to give way as to one's desire. And the only ethical question is, have you acted in conformity with the desire which inhabits you? The three ideals of psychoanalytic ethics cure are independence, authenticity, and love. And they correspond to the three tenets of the structured I, je, demarcated from the objects, authentic at the place of his own desire, and endowed with healthy love thyself narcissism, made possible via the transference of the love of the analyst towards the analyzant. At the same time, Lacan establishes the gaze as something to which the subject is originally subjected, and he claims at this point, "This is an occasion for me to respond to someone that, of course, I have my ontology, and why not? Why shouldn't I? As everybody has it, naive or elaborated." That instinct is posited in the realm in which there is an abnegation of desire, an abdication to desire, in the dangerous approach to the limit which separates the world of symbolic objects from those of the real. That gap, being the very condition of desire, that dangerous zone is of course jouissance, intense, enlivening, yet lethal for the subject structure. Is this a third death in Lacan? We die in the imaginary, in the symbolic, and in the real. This desire is motivated by this approach to the real, yet such an approach bears its own impossibility. It is therefore desire that stumbles against its own impossibility of satisfaction, but only as measured against the real, and that is why desire can be interpreted as desire to desire. For as long as the encounter with the real is postponed, desire can reproduce its own circular movement. And now let me get on to the major section on Lacan's iconoclasm, the subject, the symbolic, the death instinct, and mechanicism. Jean-Joseph Gou's answer to this problem in the article Lacan Iconoclast is the following. Lacan introduces the autonomy of the symbolic. Freud's unconscious is subject to the power of the image, predating language, as opposed to Lacan's unconscious, which is the verbal, the phonetic, the letter. Lacan extends the iconoclastic prescription to the unconscious. The end of analysis means that the patient sacrifices the imaginary and the desire for the mother. Lacan deduces the autonomy and transcendence of the symbolic, a powerful war machine deployed against the imaginary. Pure signifier is on the side of the law, the best examples of each of which are axiomatic mathematics and computer functions, the symbolic order. It is foreign to man, higher, outside of him, and man must submit to it. The scene of the imaginary is something that Gou calls and Gou names and defines as Lacanian thought being a technological iconoclasm. In an era conditioned by the triumph of technology, with the machine mastering nature and informing matter, Lacan decrees a super iconoclasm, claims Gou. Linguistics, structural anthropology, and above all, cybernetics have shown that signifiers can function, combine, and calculate without the intervention of human consciousness. Quoting Norbert Wiener from Cybernetics and Society, language is not an exclusive attribute of man, but is one which we may share to a certain degree with the machine he has constructed. This mechanographic signifier, as Gou calls it, is a new principle of absolute iconoclasm. According to Lacan, Freud is consistent with the iconoclastic prescription in one book, Beyond the Pleasure Principle. Why? Because of the automatism of repetition, that is, the mechanical insistence of the signifying chain. And that is why the death drive is a manifestation of man's subjection to a symbolic order. The machine is non-living, the machine is inanimate, the machine is death. The death instinct is the machine inside of man. With Lacan, the death drive becomes the most radical work of the symbolic order, a conception of death as a return to the father and not as the eternal prenatal sleep, oceanic feeling, a symbiotic union with the mother. And Gou considers this tautology to be Lacan's sublime loop. Okay, just further elaborating on death in Lacan. There is also death which we can find in Lacan's distinction between different types of neuroses. As we, I'm sure, recall, Freud divided neuroses, identified two major types of neuroses, hysteria and obsessional neuroses, or obsessional compulsive neuroses, I will call it obsession. And Freud he claims that his major interest in his hysteria comes from the fact that hysteria represents that enigmatic leap from the mental into the somatic. And also, hysteria was interesting because it involved the splitting, the operation of splitting. But when it comes to obsession, Freud claims that it is much more resistant to therapy. And the understanding of compulsion is much more difficult, which Freud finds really puzzling, because the means employed by obsessional neurotic are much closer to conscious thoughts. So basically, Lacan's distinction is as follows. I mean, he retained Freud's division between neurosis and psychosis, but also added perversion as a separate entity. And it's extremely important that Lacan already at the level of his doctoral dissertation worked on paranoia, and basically his doctoral dissertation is dedicated to the question of paranoia. So we can say that Freud's entry into psychoanalysis operated via neurosis, while Lacan's entry into psychoanalysis operated via psychosis. Okay, going back to the place of death in obsession, in obsessional neurosis. This is what we can call at some point somebody said that the symptoms of obsessional neurosis are of zero level, zero degree. It is, and it's really well put. Well, the symptoms are recurrent ideas, impulses to perform actions which seem absurd, and rituals, compulsively repeated actions. For Lacan, obsession is a structure organized around the question, am I dead or alive, and why do I exist? The response of the obsessional is to work frantically to justify his existence, which bears also the burden of guilt. And his attitude towards time is twofold. Either it is one of perpetual hesitation and procrastination while waiting for death, or of considering oneself immortal because he's already dead. I would just like to connect Lacan's deaths with Louise J. Kaplan's work Cultures of Fetishism. Well, she pinpoints five fetishistic strategies of the modern culture, and the fifth and the final, which are deduced but also emancipated from their origin in sexual fetishism. The fifth and the final is corollary to the necrophiliac principle, the most extreme form of sexual fetishism. And in that it exposes the death drive hidden in the folds of the erotic object, the death drive that tints itself in erotic color, the zone between living and non-living matter, mechanical creatures that are created to seem alive and human. So it is a perverted relation between living and non-living, and as well this fetishism, as the fetishism of commodities, relies upon the surplus work, and the surplus work is being transformed into profit. So fetishization is a process through which we attribute magical powers to inanimate objects, and through which the fetishist deprives himself of his own, shut up, of his own vital living forces. Kaplan's last chapter is about androids, robots, and cyborgs. The fantasy about machines which acquire are endowed with human qualities always evokes a counter-fantasy that humans can become machine-like. It is the infiltration of the mechanical into a human body. Humans become more mechanical, and machines become more human and humane. And the paradigmatic work of the robotic genre, Isaac Asimov's I, Robot, defines the ethical code of the robot, which is, you shall not harm any human being. So we are talking about empathic and compassionate robots. So in this fetishistic denial, typical of perversions, we can also trace Lacan's question, which defines an obsessional neurotic. Am I dead or alive? And is this a self-deadening, self-mortifying principle or feeling that he is already dead? How much time do I have left?
15 minutes.
15 minutes, okay, thank you. Okay, something is very obvious, but I have to just refer to some very obvious things when it comes to the fetishism of commodity. Jean-Joseph Gou, in his absolutely brilliant book from 1973, Economy and the Symbolic, just claims very, very, very directly that Marx and not Freud could invent the theory of symbolization. So, what does he say? That the central element of psychoanalysis is the interchangeability of libidinal drives. Therefore, psychoanalysis necessarily depends on the theory of the symbolic. The symbolic function is the foundation of psychoanalytic logic. So it is Marx, not Freud, who could found a general theory of the production of the symbolic. And this really is something what comes to mind when we see the relation between Althusser and Lacan. It is interesting that Althusser and Lacan say exactly the same things, Althusser in respect to Marx and Lacan in respect to Freud. And obviously their relation was very tormented, and it was mainly over the question of priority, which is first, Marxism or psychoanalysis. Althusser in respect to Marx emphasizes the same thing which Lacan emphasizes in respect to Freud. Marx, in the time Marx when he lived, could not dispose of the concept of the efficiency of the structure upon its elements. So, taking the structure of capitalism, it is obvious that the structure of man as commodity gives meaning to all other elements of the structure. In other words, it would be appropriate to raise the issue of the articulation of the structure through commodity, where the latter is the exemplary of the concept of structure. Is it that commodity is the overdetermined component of the structure, or is it that the form of commodity is such that it facilitates its interpretation as a structure, namely a structure that subsumes all human actions into its own reign? Thus, in Althusser's case, we could speak of some sort of capitalization, or rather commodification of structure. That is, of an attempt to articulate the structure precisely in line with the Marxist, actually Lukács, notion of reification, although Althusser was highly critical of Lukács' version of Hegelian Marxism. So the same question might also be directed against Lacan's structuralism, and I will just raise that question. I will now just, as I don't have much time left, I will just go to the further manifestations of death in Lacan. And basically, when we, in Jonathan Beller's book, The Cinematic Mode of Production, when he analyzes the film Matrix, he says, whatever life energy we put into the world is converted into the energy to run the image world and its illusory logic. And the dialectic between pleasure and murder underpins the society of the spectacle, Freud's pleasure and reality principle. And also in reference to Metz, speaks of hardware, software, and wetware. Existence of the unconscious as such, as cinema's product, emerges out of the dynamic relation to techno-capital. So basically, Lacan says that that Freud's only work where he speaks of which I think is has something to do with the mechanicist paradigm is beyond the pleasure principle. But there are just other works in which this machine-like quality appears, and it is also and it is Freud's essay The Uncanny, and Freud highlights the motive of the double as the most uncanny, while in enumerating other manifestations of the uncanny, ghosts, phantoms, but also mechanical dolls and marionettes. Coming to the question of intensity, it is And at the same time, you know, just coming closer to Lacan's approximating of man with machine, the discontinuity is the essential form in which the unconscious first appears to us, as Jonathan said, and it is the assembly line. So intensity is being hailed, I will go back, intensity is something that it is being, also I like that part when Jonathan says that intensity has replaced experience, because experience takes time, and it takes time. I will quote this passage. When the linguistically unrealized rises up and overwhelms the capacity of the logos for realization, what happens? This explains the rise of the term intensity as a substitute for experience, the latter being a narrative and requiring duration in order to ripen. So basically, coming back to this borderline structure, we have, I will just, as also I've been working on the cultural manifestations of the borderline, and you know, the new vampire genre is a brilliant example, because I wrote an article with my student who had to undergo the ordeal of watching all vampire movies and soap operas. And the best thing, you know, so I think the new vampire, the fictional new vampire, and the emerging borderline subject, what they have in common is intensity. The good vampire from the Vampire Diaries, that is a true soap opera, says to his loving Elena, Stefan, his name is Stefan, once you become a vampire, everything concerning yourself becomes so intense. Positive and negative emotions become extremely intensified. This emotional and erotic intensity is closely connected to the death drive, a mandatory trait of the new dark vampire borderline romance. And there is a sinister possibility of erotica suddenly turning into thanatica. It is always present, at which point you can gloriously cry out, "I have experienced love at first bite." Okay, we have to emphasize the crucial distinction in psychoanalytic theory between the pleasure principle and pleasures as ecstasy, most clearly defined through Lacan's concept of jouissance, and also Slavoj Žižek's diagnosis of socially mandatory borderline forms causing the impotence of psychoanalysis in his foreword to the creation edition of Christopher Lasch's Culture of Narcissism. Okay, so the approximation of the structure of the subject with the machine is most salient in Lacan's second seminar in the chapters Freud, Hegel, and the machine. I will just quote this very important passage from Lacan's second seminar. I'm just going to paraphrase it because I don't have time. Well, he said that, you know, the founder of modern biology, Bichat, knew that we were entering a new era, and that from then on, everything would be defined in its relation to death. And from this, Lacan concludes that you know, we have to think about personality structure, about a subject in its reference to death. Libidinal energetics, as the Freudian discovery, will in Lacan be modified into the energetics of the symbolic order itself, which is the question I tackled in my doctoral thesis, lately published as a book, by which Lacan also dispenses with the libidinal character of Freudian energetics. The symbolic world is the world of the machine. Lacan's reliance on mechanicism is directed against Hegelian organicism, that is, against an organicist conception of consciousness which is reconciled with the world in the end. The conception that has to propose a properly organicist view of the human mind. It is for Lacan an anthropomorphic illusion, proven by his recourse to the world of the inanimate, and rejecting strictly what he calls delirious anthropomorphism. Thus, the Freudian problem of beyond the pleasure principle is, in Lacan's view, a purely symbolic problem. So by opposing energetics to organicism, and by approximating mechanicism to symbolicism, Lacan is able to justify his articulation of the subject, and says that the dimension that we discover in analysis is something which progresses through adaptations, through approximations, is contrary to something which progresses through adaptations, through approximations, through perfectioning. It is something which does not progress, it just repeats its primal and fundamental malfunctioning. And also, it is the that's the apogee of the learning process. Okay, Freud's entire drive theory consists precisely in the attempt not to conceptualize inner nature, but to elucidate the frontier between soma and psyche, as well as the frontier between the image and the word. We know that those most common critiques of Freud's position have been articulated, were articulated by Derrida and Ricoeur, and that Freud's death instinct is the rewriting of his earlier energetic notion of homeostasis. I will just conclude. Yes, that would be okay. There is a question which was emphasized by, again, Joel Whitebook in Perversion and Utopia, where he singled out Freud's one of Freud's weakest points. And as Whitebook says, Freud could never explain how a psychic apparatus operating according to the pleasure principle alone could renounce hallucinatory wish fulfillment and decide to form a conception of the real circumstances in the external world and endeavor to make a real alteration in them, unless we cling to the conviction that it is the force of sheer paternal interdiction placed upon the mother's body. Lacan was fully aware of this duality of instincts and of the impossibility for the self to leave this enclosed circle. Lacan highly praises this Freudian dualism and attempts to justify it by resorting to the logic of the signifier. At the same time, he sees that very dualism falling under a threat of the principle of integration. Freud's dualism is precisely the dualism that I have in mind when I put forward the autonomy of the symbolic, but Freud never formulated this, says Lacan. So Lacan hypostatizes the desire for recognition as a fundamental tendency of the human psyche, which really pushes us out of the so-called narcissistic fascination with our mirror image. That is underpinned by the desire to know whether the image, whether for the subject, yeah, that the image is really him. In other words, the desire for perfect recognition. The introduction of the symbolic order would not rest upon a pure interdiction, but on the subject's desire, hope, expectation, and yes, allure, that language is an appropriate medium of bringing recognition, where we can ask questions, who am I? Narcissistic images are most vibrant and resonate perfectly when they are subliminally reduced to some basic defining sentences such as, I am omnipotent and you are nothing but a part of me. You are omnipotent and I'm the mirror which reflects, confirms you as such. And referring to Freud's speculative phase and to Freud's death instinct, Lacan emphasizes often how it is precisely that last phase that is crucial to the understanding of Freud's work, and his warning acquires biblical proportions. And he really says, if somebody, those who neglect the death instinct, they know not what they do. And just a few more sentences. Well, in my paper, I try to emphasize the mystery surrounding obsessional pathology, the way it is in Lacan connected to the relation of life and death, but mostly death. And the largest part of my paper was dedicated to the investigation of multiple deaths in Lacan's theory. This was further approximated to fetishism in modern culture, the redefinition of human and mechanistic. Being a well-functioning subject is hailed, advertised and produced by capitalism together with the production of diagnosis by the big pharma and the American Psychiatric Association. The mainstream culture, or rather popular culture, promotes intensity as the only measure of aliveness. Yet too much intensity is being easily classified as borderline disorder. So the message is be intense, or actually you have to be intense, but not too intense, as you will end up getting a borderline personality disorder. Lacan's mechanistic paradigm and his concept of jouissance as intensity, which tears us apart, are of utmost importance, I think, in any discussion of the personality structure today. Thank you very much.